Memorial Day, we honor millions of men and women who have given their lives for our freedom. As Americans, we have great privilege and freedom because of the high price that was paid by these heroes. As Christians, we have even a greater privilege of freedom because of the high price paid by Jesus Christ for our salvation. Just as we rightly set aside a day to honor our nation's heroes, we should also take time to give thanks to God for our spiritual liberty and His many blessings to us. One of those benefits is His love for us. As you've seen just a few moments ago on the screen, no greater love than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Jesus said, "You're my friend." And boy, what a friend we have in Jesus. Not only did He lay down His life so that we might have life, but He also, amen, conquered death, hell, and the grave for you and I to live for eternity. Paul wrote these words as a reflection of what Christ did for us. In Romans 5:8, he says, "But God commended His love toward us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, displaying His great love for us to give us all of those benefits that we just discussed." Boy, I tell you what, I'm looking forward, amen, to living eternally with God. Why? Because of His great love for me. He loves me here, and He loves me over there. His love will never fade. His love will never be lost. His love is forever. For God is love, and that's one of His attributes, Frank. Amen. He is love. And love, amen, engulfs all the other attributes of God. And one of them I'm grateful and thankful for is His love. For without His love, where would we be? Where would we be? And I thank God, amen, His love is not as the world's love of definition is. Amen? Because His love goes beyond anything that we can ever comprehend. Nothing that we have done or failed to do keeps God from loving us. He sent His Son as an expression of that love to provide us the way of salvation. The love that Christ has for us cannot be measured, and once again, it will never, never, ever end. Never forget the freedom that was purchased for you by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and never forget the freedom you have in America because of the men and women who sacrificed all for those freedoms. So today, as we honor those who gave all for our freedom here in America, let's not forget the victory and freedom once again we have in Jesus Christ. So tomorrow is what? A day of reflection. A day of reflection. Some say it's Memorial Day. I like to call it a day of reflection. It's a day we reflect upon all the battles that have occurred to bring us freedom here in America. But I also want to not only take a day to remember that, but I want to take a day to remember and reflect on what the Lord Jesus Christ did for all mankind. Not just for one country, but for the entire world. A day of reflection. So if I'm going to have a day of reflection, then I have to have a memory, don't I? I have to remember what took place, right? So I had to be taught about that to be able to reflect upon it, right? Somebody help me out, someone. We have to be taught, amen, what to reflect on. Because we didn't live through the Revolutionary War. We didn't live through the Civil War. Some of us, amen, experienced the Vietnam War. But we never, amen, in the wars of the past, we never lived in that era. So we don't know. Somebody had to teach us about that. World War I, World War II, the Korean War. Some of you may remember that, but I don't. But the fact is, somebody had to teach us. And I don't remember, amen, and live back in the period of time. Or let me put it that way. I didn't live back in the period of time when Christ walked upon the earth. So I had to be taught about that. I didn't see him crucified on the hill of Calvary. I didn't see that. Somebody had to teach me about that to be able to reflect upon it. And if to reflect upon those things, we have to be taught. And the Word of God said we have a teacher that will teach us, amen, those things. The teacher is the Holy Ghost. John 14, 26, Jesus said, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you." Those things, amen, that he says, I've taught you. And we have the Word of God today that teaches us about what Christ did for us and for our freedom and salvation. Amen. It teaches us everything. But he says, to help you to comprehend that, I'm going to give you my Spirit inside of you. And glory to God. Amen. When I get to the Holy Ghost, some Baptist, amen, crawls up under the pew because he don't know, amen, what the Holy Ghost is all about. The Holy Ghost is a comforter. It's a teacher. It is God himself dwelling in us. And God said, I'll bring all things to your remembrance what I have taught you. I want you to reflect on me this morning. I want you to reflect on what I've done for you. Glory to God. It's more than any man will ever do for you. Even those great soldiers who we honor, amen, over Memorial Day, cannot match up to what God has done for humanity. And glory to God, amen. He said, and the Holy Spirit will teach you those things and bring those to your remembrance so you can, I can share them. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Yeah, I want to reflect on what God did for me. Reflect. And I also, don't get me wrong, I want to remember those men and women who made the ultimate sacrifice so I could preach like I'm preaching this morning to you. I ain't got to crawl in a hole. Amen. Go underground with it. It might be in the future, but right now I'm above ground giving you the Word of God. Amen. And we should reflect on those things. He said that Holy Ghost will bring all things to your remembrance, whatever I've said unto you. It will search the human mind. Within a human mind, there's a lot to sort through. But God says, my Spirit will search the human mind. Also, it will search the deep things of God. God knows all, sees all, amen. And you can't get away from him. He's all wisdom and knowledge. So whatever we got going on in our minds cannot, amen, proceed above the wisdom and knowledge of God. So he can search, amen, the human mind, but he can go with the deep things of God because human minds can't comprehend God. Are you with me? We can get an idea who God is through his word, but we can never comprehend God in a humanistic way. Because he said, my thoughts are not your thoughts and my ways are not your ways. They're much far beyond us. Oh, so to help me reflect on what God has done, the Holy Spirit brings those things to my remembrance as I read and study his word. That's why we preach to you about Bible study, small groups, amen. Boy, getting into the Word of God in your daily devotion, your quiet times, that's where you learn about who God is. And as you learn about who God is, His Holy Spirit reveals Him to you. Amen, through your everyday life. So with that in mind, the reflection part also brings up, amen, promises that God has given to us. And promises is God, amen, gives to us. Each and every day, he keeps those promises. Men make promises and break them. I said men make promises and breaks them. A mankind men and women alike, will tell you they'll do this or they'll do that. And the next thing you know, you don't see them buzzards. Right? They broke the promise. They broke the word. Used to be in America, a man's word was his bond. If a man told you something, he delivered. And you knew his character by his words. I think by studying the word of God, you see his promises in his word. His promises. First thing he promised was a savior for mankind. Even before the foundation of the world, the Bible said he was making plans to die for you and me. Die for you and me. He knew that we would fail him and that he needed to bridge the gap between God and man. He made a way through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Paul spoke of this on the day of Pentecost. Y'all remember Pentecost? Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost. Jesus ascended back into heaven and he told the disciples, go to the upper room and pray till they was endued with power from above. That Holy Ghost came down. The Spirit of God came down, filled the hearts of 120 in the upper room. Y'all remember? Anybody remember reading that? Don't put me in this book by myself. Help me out. Hell, amen. They was in the upper room praying in one mind, one accord. If the church will pray in one mind and one accord, what can we accomplish today? Hello? Absolutely, Bristol. See, everything. We could accomplish great things for God. But we can't even come together and sing one hymn in unity. Hello? I don't like that hymn. Why they sing that hymn? Well, what you singing it for? Hello? You're singing it to God to uplift him, not you. Uplift him for what he's done for you. And if you have the Holy Spirit, amen, he would reflect upon that and tell you, amen, it ain't about you, it's about him. Come on. But we've gotten out of unity. We need to reflect a little bit more, don't we? On the day of Pentecost, they was in an upper room in one mind, in one accord. The Bible said they were praying, amen, for God to endure them with power so the word of God would reach out unto the world. And when the church got on the knees and started praying in that fashion, God sent his Holy Spirit down. And glory to God, the word of God began to reach, amen, out unto the world. Because in Jerusalem at the time, the Bible said that there was devout men from all nations of the world gathered in that city. And when they heard, amen, what was taking place in the upper room, in other words, when they heard that the word of God was being delivered by a man named Peter, they began to tune in and listen, every man in his own language. Woo! And boy, let me tell you, Peter said, this is a promise. This is a promise made by God. To Jesus you crucified. He paid a debt for your sin that you could not pay. He died to bridge a gap that you were not able to bridge. And that was from man to God. He didn't say in the exact words, but you read it. Hello? He said, listen, there was a promise made and a promise that was kept. God never fails at his promise. Devout men from every nation of the world. They was having what we call a modern-day summit. That's a political term. I don't know what they summit. They don't learn nothing today. They just go to meet. Hello? But they must have been gathered there to learn something because they tuned in to what Peter had to say, and they learned about Jesus Christ. He gave his life. He said, y'all crucified him, but y'all thought he was dead. Y'all thought you'd done away with him. You thought he won't never get up out of the grave, but he did. He got up on the third day. And guess what? He said he didn't run off. He stayed with us for another 40 days after his resurrection. He stayed with us and told us as he ascended to heaven, he'll come back in the same manner. So I'm here today to tell you, Jesus Christ loves you. He died for your sin, and he brought salvation, amen, to your life if you want it. And the people said, how can we do it? How can we get it? How can we get it? How can we get the salvation that he's granted to us? This free gift, by the way, amen, this free gift. And Peter said, repent of your sins. Boy, you don't hear about repentance in church no more, do you? Oh, we don't want to hurt their feelings. They might not come back. Well, I'd rather hurt your feelings and not come back than to see your soul burn in hell. And you tell me, you didn't tell me. Yeah, the Bible says repent. That means to turn from your evil ways and your evil doings. Amen. Repent, turn away, not just engage deeper. Turn away. If you're doing something against the Word of God, you know it's against the Word of God. God has instilled in each heart, amen, I believe without a shadow of doubt, you know right from wrong. You know when you're doing wrong, but you choose to do it wrong. You got to choose to do right. Everybody is faced with choices. He says, you'll never be tempted above that which you are able to stand. Amen. That means you got, amen, sense enough to choose right from wrong. Whew, don't get quiet on me now. The problem is we don't preach repentance anymore, and we don't preach what sin is anymore. A lie is a sin. Stealing is a sin. We can go down the list and on. But why don't we preach it? Peter said, repent. Turn from your sin. And you can receive the gift of salvation. Woo! That means, amen, when salvation comes, God creates, amen, a new individual. Well, how do you know that? Reflection. Hello? Upon the Word of God. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, and when you say, I'm sorry for my sin, Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save my soul, he comes in. And if he comes in, he's going to clean the house, because he's not going to dwell in an unclean vessel. He's going to clean the house. I know some of you ladies, like, you like everything clean. Because when we men come in the house, and take them shoes off, put them over in the corner, pick up your clothes, pick up your clothes, wash your dishes. Don't leave them dishes in the sink. Put them in the dishwasher. That's why you bought me that dishwasher. You want to buy me two? Because you done filled that one up and you ain't pushed the wash button yet. And think of this. It just occurred to me. Jesus up in heaven sometimes saying, you got too many dirty dishes. Hello? Push the wash button. Ask for forgiveness. Let's cleanse the dishes up. As Frank said, turn the antenna. You heard a tune. Turn the antenna. I can relate to what he was saying, but some of the new generations, amen, they don't relate to that. They don't even know what an antenna is. Probably don't even know what a payphone is now. Hello? See a telephone booth. What was that? That's the way Superman changed. Yeah. Who's Superman? Right? I better go on and get back on. But we need to push the wash button. We got too many dirty dishes. God wants to cleanse us up. He said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a... a what? A new creation.
old things. Old means your old sin nature is now being replaced with a new nature, which is a divine nature in Jesus Christ. Your divine nature now must supersede the old nature. The old is gone, the new is in. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Woo! Some of my Baptist friends ain't caught on to that yet, because when I started church in 94, a lot of them called me up and said, "What are you?" I said, "What do you mean by that? What are you?" I said, "I'm a Christian. But your name on the church said New Beginning Tabernacle. Don't have Baptists in it." I said, "The Baptists, amen, didn't save me. Jesus did. Therefore, he gave me a new beginning." A new beginning. And tabernacle, if you study the word and reflect upon it, it's just a temporary place of worship. Temple was built in Jerusalem. Not when Jerusalem was built for the temple. My mind trying to put them words in the wrong place. Tabernacle means temporary place of worship till the temple was built in Jerusalem. We are in a temporary place of worship till we get to the new temple in Jerusalem. Hello? In the temple of God. Amen. In the holy city. Amen. The holy city. Not the one down here. The holy city of heaven, where God is. So I want to reflect upon that. Peter reflected upon what God's promises was, and he delivered, amen, that message to the people to remind them, hey, this is what God promised them, and this is what God did. He delivered. Now, folks, amen, why did he tell them about that? Because there's a battle going on for you and I. There's a battle between evil and good. God being good, evil means Satan. Satan is out to destroy you. God is out to give you victory. So there's a battle going on. And let me tell you this, is it a battle going on within us? Absolutely. Paul says, amen. He said, when I want to do right, wrong is present. When I do wrong, good is present. And there's a constant struggle for me in my heart and mind as which one to choose. There's a power struggle going on. Remember, amen, Jesus is in you, so greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world, and you have to reflect upon that verse when it comes to the battle. In other words, the divine nature that moved in you ain't no wimp. You said, greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Get thee behind me, Satan, in the name of Jesus. He'll fear and tremble at that name. Why? He knows, amen, he's up against the champion of all champions. You hear me? And Jesus never lost a match. Satan thought he would try Jesus one time. He thought he'd get in the ring with him. Are y'all ready? I don't know how I got here on wrestling match here, but anyhow. Satan come out with his tutu on, jumped up in the ring with the greatest champion of all times, Jesus Christ, in Matthew 4. He danced around and did a little ropey-dopey, you know. He said, if you be the Son of God, make these stones bread. You've been hungry. You've been fasting and praying for 40 days. And let me remind you, Satan comes at your weakest point. He's going to attack you at your weakest point. Hello? What's your weakest point? Only you know that. So what he's going to do, he's going to attack you. And God knows we like to eat. That's one weakness we all got. Whether you like to eat a little bit or a whole lot, we like to eat. Make these stones bread. He got a little tutu on. He make these stones bread. You can do it. Yeah, I can. But I'm not. Man shall not. It is written, he said.
man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Hello?
He hit little Tutu and knocked him up against the rope. And he put a rope-a-dope on him. He'd come back and give him a wahoo chop. Knocked him down on the mat. But that won't it. I don't know how I got here, won't in my notes, but hey, amen, we're here. He come to him several different times, but he failed to trip him up. And Satan will fail to trip you up when you rely on God's word. When you rely on God's word, he can never trip you up. Even if he hits you in the weakest point, he can never trip you up. And I'll move on, amen. Because there is a battle. In Ephesians 6, it says this. Paul says, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that he may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God that he may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, and having the breastplate plate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, and above all, taking the shield of faith wherewith he should be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto, with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. But he says, be strong in the Lord. And how can you be strong in the Lord unless you put his word in your heart? Hide that word in my heart, Lord, that I might not sin against you. Freedom comes with a price. And that price is death. Jesus paid the price of death to set you free. He died for you on the cross to set you free and deliver you from the powers of your enemy, Satan, who is trying to destroy both body and soul in hell. So reflect upon the price that was paid for you, that Jesus loved you enough to pay that price for you. And you should love him enough to break free